Namaskar. My name is Satyajit Majumdar. I am professor at Center for Social Entrepreneurship, School of Management and Labor Studies at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. I teach courses related to entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship, strategic management, service operation management, business plan, business model, and CSR. Also, I closely associate with startups, social and business entrepreneurs, help them designing the business model, writing the business plan, and of course, helping them to devise their accelerated growth plan also. I closely look at the startups and small businesses, and also do a bit of research in terms of understanding the processes and the learnings, whatever it comes as a matter of theoretical framework concern. So today I'm going to discuss two major things. One is the support system, what we call as ecosystem support, and the second is what are the major or few major government schemes and programs today which are available for the young entrepreneurs to work on and take the advantage of their existence and help to grow. When I talk about the government schemes, let me put a disclaimer up front, because that's very important for all of us who teach entrepreneurship or who mentor entrepreneurs, that entrepreneurs are not the one who become entrepreneur because there is a government scheme. Entrepreneurs are the one who want to do something on their own. They feel independent, they feel passionate, they desire to do something different, and there's a long desire to change something. The something could be a product, a business model, or a social system. So it doesn't matter really whether the government support system exists or doesn't exist. Only government support system existence help somebody to grow little faster and also grow little smoother. So what I mean to say is nobody can become entrepreneur because the government system prevails. People become entrepreneur because they would like to become entrepreneurs. So nevertheless, as an educator, as a teacher, we need to be a little sensitive about this aspect of entrepreneurship life. So coming to understanding of ecosystem, and which is critical for creating enterprises or entrepreneurs in a given system. It's very important for us to understand that sometimes ecosystem is considered to be socio-economic or economic, political economic situation under which entrepreneur finds something favorable or something not favorable to create an enterprise. But I think ecosystem is also a little beyond that. So the traditional view that entrepreneurship could be seen as a push or pull is something which has its own limited connotation. We need to be a little cautious about that. Yes, there are some push type entrepreneurship, means the individual faces a condition because of which he or she decides to become an entrepreneur. Typical situation is when we are in political distress, when we are in warlike situation, when people migrate because of some compulsion, maybe because of the war, because of earthquake, because of flood, and people migrate from one city to the other city. When they travel to the other place, they find it very difficult to find jobs. So they tend to start something on their own, which we call as self-employment or maybe little livelihood kind of activities. Eventually, all these livelihood activities or self-employment activities become something successful enterprises. And there are good Indian stories which we can always narrate. I think one of the best story, though it's not a warlike situation story, but nevertheless, how somebody started with a very small enterprise mode is Karsan Bhai, who created Nirma as one of the most sought after brand in Indian detergent market. So it's very important for us to understand that not always everybody starts with a big money. I think and sometimes the ecosystem is not very supportive, but nevertheless, ecosystem is an institutional framework which we are referring, which describes the complexity and the dynamics of the external environment under which entrepreneurship can be talked about. So if we understand ecosystem, probably we can educate our youth little better. We can educate our students little better. We can tell them that these are the things which are favorable and these are the things which could be challenging. I'm not saying things which are hostile, but what I'm saying is things where the student or the young entrepreneurs have to evolve and see something beyond obvious. So, the first element which we can look at, which is very obvious and all of us talk about, is the economic analysis of the market, or economic analysis which we call as typically in Michael Porter's language industry structure analysis. So, industry structure analysis typically talks about the techno-economic parameters under which an enterprise can operate, the industry behaves, and we can also map our competitive advantage on that. So, that is the macro view or economic view which we can always teach to the students, or we can articulate and also understand ourselves where the competitive advantage lies. What is important is the framework. I think a framework where we can describe the political, economic, cultural, social dynamics is very important. For example, a few years back, if some youth finishes his education and his or her education and goes back to the family saying that I want to become an entrepreneur, I think family will feel worried about the person. The family would say that you are well educated, you deserve a good job, you deserve a good salary, you deserve a good life, you deserve a good house, a good car probably, and why not you settle in your life early. Because becoming an entrepreneur in typical non-entrepreneurial society is something which is seen as a very high risk proposition, and family probably would not support, and we have seen such many such cases where the family pressure, even in fact I have mentored quite a few of such youngsters where the family pressure became very, very difficult situation, and the entrepreneurs found it extremely uncomfortable in terms of fighting with the family ethos and norms and say that I want to become an entrepreneur. Though there are cases where people have really won over the family pressures, but there are people who could not. So, I am not saying that one should do or one should not do. What I am saying is the social system plays a very important role in entrepreneurial ecosystem. The second is political, where political does not mean the political party. Political means the power politics, the power dynamics. How the power dynamics help small businesses to grow, new startups to grow, versus the large businesses which creates a monopoly or which creates entry barrier for new entrants to come. And there are some political discourses around that. The cultural could be little bit more in terms of understanding the cultural ethos and values, where earning money, earning profit is acceptable or not, where not having a fixed income in the family is culturally acceptable or not, and so on and so forth. So, cultures are basically in the norms which we all believe. There could be irrational cultural norm and there could be rationality behind it. I am not going to sort of be a critic of cultural norm. What I am saying is there are certain society where the cultural norm permits or supports entrepreneurship, and there are some which do not. The third thing which is important is the physical facility, the resources available. When I say physical facilities, it could be simple road network, it could be port network, it could be air connectivity, train connectivity, the other transports and logistics, the storage facility, the factory environment, the raw material availability, etcetera, etcetera. So, these are also critical part of the ecosystem. So, ecosystem actually helps us to look through the entire externalities of the environment, which includes the software aspect of it also. I will discuss about it a little later, and see what is doable and how we are supportive or not supportive to the entrepreneurship, enterprise creation or startup creation. So, the elements of entrepreneurship ecosystem could be legal and regulatory framework, which we see very supportive these days. The current government has brought out lot of plans, lot of supportive systems in terms of funding, in terms of classifying startups and so on and so forth, and also helping them quite a lot in terms of giving them exposure to international platforms. So, that is legal and regulatory framework. The second one is access to finance, which is also seem to be very supportive these days. But when I say access to finance, it does not mean only banking finance system, it means the other financial system also, which I will refer little later. Access to market, which is also seem to be very supportive, especially post 1992, the free market mechanisms, where the exports are less regulated, availability of raw material is little easy, and there are less licensing, less regulatory framework, which prevents a new company to start and working with. The business support structure, as I discussed before, availability of the physical resources, space, road network, rail network, etcetera. So, that is another element of it. And the fourth is the softer element, which we call as research, R&D, scientific research, the training facility. Today we talk a lot about startups in startup phase as incubators. There are different types of incubators, science and technology incubators and otherwise also. So there are different type of elements which collectively supports or not support the enterprise creation. So that's the, those are the elements which are very important for us to analyze, articulate and understand how we can navigate through them and create something which is sustainable. The themes of social enterprise, as I was referring before, are the social, cultural and economic context, which we have understood quite a bit, but it is also important for us to understand the legal structure, the government support systems, also the policy environment, how it is supportive or not. Like in today's context, there is no clear cut policy framework for social enterprises and we are struggling hard to figure out what is the right legal framework under which the social enterprises should work. Should they work as a trust or a society, or should they work as a private limited company, should they work like a partnership firm, or should they work only as a Section 8 company, which we call as not for profit company. So these are some of the frameworks which we need to refer to, and I hope that in time to come we will have a social entrepreneurship policy. I'm slightly related to this discipline, and also I'm helping an agency to write a national social entrepreneurship policy. The support structure, especially in today's context, the role of incubators, where incubators are there in a formal structure within the university environment, within science and technology laboratory environment, which is typically what we call as TBI, technology based incubators, and also non-TBIs also, there are quite a few out there, where the Department of Science and Technology of Government of India supports with a lot of very, very progressive and lucrative support system which prevails in incubators. On the informal incubator side, we see almost every tier 2, tier 3 city of today having startup clubs where young entrepreneurs come, meet, discuss and go back. So that also works like a kind of informal incubation system where pro bono basis mentors come, help these youngsters to think about a product, think about a market and also design a business model based on the consultation, and of course they ideate about a lot of things. Also we see shared workspace coming up in several small towns and cities where you need not have a lavish big office, you can just go to a small place, hire a table, hire a computer, hire a small office facility and at a very, very nominal rate you can work around. So these are different formats of incubator which are happening. Some of incubators have seed funding facilities, some of them do not, because there is a larger investing community which is waiting outside the incubators, which can also be connected to this incubator system. Another important element of enterprise creation is the network. Network are very critical, where we connect to each other to share. As I said before, the startup clubs are informal networks. And of course, there are formal networks also where like Indian Angel Network, and there are others also. TAI is another network where these people actually in a structured way, in an institutional way, interested people come together and help the youngsters to think through a sustainable enterprise model. And of course, there is a significant role which educational and similar institutes can play. Where they can teach, they can mentor, they can train youngsters in enterprise creation. So these are a few areas. In addition to that, as I discussed before, resources, I have discussed a lot about non-financial resources. The financial resources of today's time are angel investment, impact investment, the commercial investment at different level, the crowdfunding, debt and equity funding, specific fund allocated by the government, like government has specific funds which I will discuss a little bit later for agriculture, for science and technology, etc. And also there are few high net worth individuals, there are family trust, there are foundations who invest and believe that that's the way they can contribute to enterprise creation, in addition to CSR initiative. In some cases we can find CSR also supportive. Science and technology research facilities are also upfront, very much progressive. Even some CSIR labs have their own incubators attached to them and they are working pretty well. The prominent one which comes to my mind at this point of time is the Venture Center, which is attached to the National Chemical Laboratory of CSIR in Pune. So there are many such organizations which are there to support the science and technology research, and also business organizations which provide mentor support in supply chain management, market access, marketing, branding, etc. So in terms of the physical elements, maybe we can look at the geographical terrain, we can see the whole gamut of physical facility which every state government is contemplating to improve. So, some of the prominent government schemes which are available today, before I start naming them, the prominent one, I would request all of you to kindly look at the Government of India's websites of different ministries, because they are very dynamic. Every time government comes with a new proposition, new proposal, government is also very dynamic these days, and they are talking about very new schemes. So, kindly refer to the latest schemes and propositions, because these things are very dynamic. So, I think the most talked about government scheme which we can refer today is Mudra. Mudra is basically an underwriting scheme initiated by the Government of India, which actually primarily focuses on startup funding through banks, and all the banks are a part of that. The maximum loan available in this is rupees 10 lakh, and it's a very lucrative, it's very encouraging to avail Mudra loan, which is available very, very easily, and it's available through various channels. Some non-financing institution, non-banking finance institutions, even foreign banks. Some foreign banks are also associated with that. So I think Mudra is one of the popular scheme for startups, which one can easily avail. The second scheme probably which we can refer to is Stand Up India. Stand Up India is the bank loan facility between 10 lakh and 1 crore, available with a very ambitious proposition of one scheduled caste candidate, one scheduled tribe candidate, one woman candidate in each bank branch to be funded by these entities. This covers 75% of the total project cost in terms of term loan and working capital loan, and also very lucrative interest rate. It's a very, very lucrative interest rate under which these loans are provided. So, this is another scheme which actually seemed to be very promising for those community and those locations which are considered to be marginalized, and these communities can be encouraged to avail this kind of loan to get a fairly decent startup fund. There is a growth capital and equity assistant startup scheme, which kind of for the startup or early stage enterprises, which is available in the domains like technology, biotechnology, solar, and of course, it looks at web based business models, mobile based business models, and of course, very strong focus on clean technologies. So, these are the areas which is less asset intensive, but there are few select areas where the scheme is also available for asset intensive spaces. So, this is managed by SIDBI, Small Industries Development Bank of India. So, one can look at this discipline also. In addition to that, there are sector specific funds available, which are large fund pools for prototyping, for product development, for technology development. They are available by the different ministries and different agencies. So, kindly look at the websites of the these respective ministries. Some of them are available in green technology, some of them are available in dairy, agriculture, animal husbandry, food. The roles are available for agriculture. Biotechnology is the prominent one, where BIRAC is very active, and also there are different technology domains like chemical materials, design, product design, IoT, etcetera, where different technology development programs are supported. The last scheme which I would like to refer is the incubation support system, which is being initiated by Niti Aayog under Atal Innovation Mission, and there are different formats of that. So, one can look at those incubators also. They are there in small towns and cities. Even some of the cities have more than one Atal Incubation Center. So, I think it's really very promising to look at those kind of agencies and look at them. So, to sum up, I would like to sort of re-emphasize on two points. As I said before, availability of fund doesn't mean that somebody should become an entrepreneur. Becoming an entrepreneur is very much a desire of an individual. So, it's very important for somebody to understand his or her potential to act independently, to work like an entrepreneur. And there are different kind of people of different caliber. One can look at that. What is important is to have a supportive ecosystem. So, we are fortunate that the country is having one of the best times so far as entrepreneurial ecosystem, which includes the entire gamut of support system, right from socio-political system to financing to market access to physical facilities and to the whole support education and knowledge support system. And I have referred to few general government schemes like Mudra and Stand Up India, which are available. One can look at the websites of the government of India, different department, and also there are private funds available through Impact Investment and several other schemes, and of course there are private investments available, angel investment available, and also sector specific fund available by the government of India for prototype development and for technology development. So we can encourage our youth to look into this and create something which is meaningful to the society, and I am sure all of us can think together to change the society as an entrepreneurial society where there is a vibrant youth population which thinks beyond horizon. Thank you very much.